All right, good morning. I am now going to solve a quadratic in a second way called completing the square. Now, remember, when I am solving a quadratic, I'm actually looking for its solutions, its zeros, its roots, its x-intercepts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. When completing the square, when I'm solving, remember, it's typically set equal to zero. So before, this problem actually looks like this, a normal quadratic. So I have 8x squared plus 16x minus 42 is equal to zero. The nice thing about my problem, the way I had it set up, was the fact that I had actually already moved my constant onto the right-hand side of my equation like I wanted to, okay? All right, so I have an issue here. I have an a value. Now, if you don't have an a value, which is attached to the x squared, then you're in good luck because you don't have to do much. However, in this situation, I actually have to deal with the fact that I have an a value. So what I'm going to do, I could do two things here. I could divide everything by the a term. Now, that'll be, that's useful here when you're solving, when it's set equal to zero. But when there's a y, which we're going to have when we're graphing, we don't like to do that. We like to factor. So let's actually work on factoring. So we are going to factor out the a term from both of these two terms. Now, that doesn't change the meaning of the equation. I haven't done anything that ruins my problem. So when I factor out the 8, I'm left with x squared plus, well, 8 goes into 16 two times, plus 2x equals 42. Nothing changed. I didn't do one thing to one side, which affected the other side. I'm okay. So now I'm actually going to make room for completing the square inside of my parentheses. And I always like to put a square just to show that I'm actually going to complete the square. Now, this is where you have to be careful. What you do to one side, you have to do to the other side. Now, this square is actually being multiplied by the 8. So it's really 8 times the square, and I'm adding it. So I really have to add 8 times the square onto the other side. Now, there are two things to do to fill in my square, to essentially complete my square. I'm going to take this b term, okay? I'm going to take the b coefficient, which is a 2. I'm going to cut him in half, and then I'm going to square the result, okay? So I'll verbalize it. 2 cut in half, well, that's 1. 1 squared, that's 1. I picked a really good problem for this. So I'm filling in my completed square of 1, okay? So over here, I have 42 plus 8 times 1. Well, 42 times 8 plus 1, well, that would be 50. The whole purpose, the whole reason I wanted to complete the square was because I wanted to create a perfect square trinomial. X squared plus 2x plus 1 actually creates a perfect square trinomial. What that means is it creates a perfect square factor. What multiplies to be 1 and adds to be 2, that's 1 and 1. So essentially what our factors would look like is x plus 1 times x plus 1. X times x is x squared. X times 1, or another 1 times x, that's 2x. And 1 times 1 is 1. But why would I want to write this twice? It appears twice. So essentially, it's just this term squared. Okay? So I have 8 times the quantity, x plus 1 squared equals 50. Alrighty. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide everything by 8. So we have x plus 1, the quantity squared, equals 50 divided by 8. So let's see if we can simplify this fraction. I'm noticing that they are both actually even numbers, so I know that I can cut them in half and divide by 2. 8 divided by 2 is 4. 50 divided by 2 is 25. Can't go any further. So I have the quantity x plus 1 squared is equal to 25/4. Next step. I got to get rid of this square. To undo a square, the inverse operation is to take the square root. So I'm actually going to take the square root of both sides. And something that's important to mention is the fact that you have to always put a plus or a minus. Because you can have a positive solution or a negative solution. That means I can plug in a positive x here, and because it's being squared, no matter what, I'll get this solution. Or I can plug in a negative quantity into this quantity here, and because it's being squared, it's still going to get me that positive solution. So when I take the square root, it undoes the square, so I'm left with x plus 1 equals. Now, we haven't gotten into radical properties yet, but let me just tell you, there is no addition happening. There is no subtraction happening. So essentially, you can take the square root of 25 divided by the square root of 4. Well, the square root of 25 is 5. So that's Ms. Rudolph's favorite square. And the square root of 4 is 2. Now remember, we have plus or minus. We have the positive 5 halves or we have the negative 5 halves. The last thing to do to get x by itself is to subtract 1. So we have x equals negative 1 plus or minus 5 halves. Now because these are nice numbers, because they're not left in radicals, we can go further. We have negative 1 plus 5 over 2. Okay, well that's really negative 2 over 2 plus 5 over 2, which is equal to 3 over 2. There's one of our answers. We also have negative 1 minus 5 over 2. So we have negative 2 over 2 minus 5 over 2. So we really have negative 7 halves. All right, just a reminder, these values that we just found, these are also called my roots. Essentially, they're called my factors. They're my x-intercepts. They're my solutions. I think I'm missing another one here. But this was solving by completing the square. Remember, the two things that we did to complete the square, we cut this v term in half, and then we squared him. That filled in my box. Now, what you do to one side, you had to do the other side. But because my square here was really being multiplied by the 8, I couldn't just throw a box onto the other side. I had to throw 8 times that completed square. Be very careful.